Okay, welcome everybody. I'm Maurice Samuels, the director of the Yale Program for the Study of Antisemitism. And on behalf of YPSA and the Program in Judaic Studies, it's a great privilege to introduce today's speaker, Cary Nelson, the Jubilee Professor of Liberal Arts and Sciences and Professor of English at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. He's known to many of you, I'm sure, but I'll just rehearse his many accomplishments. He's the author and editor of numerous books on American poetry, including Our Last First Poets, Vision and History in Contemporary American Poetry, 1981, Repression and Recovery, Modern American Poetry and the Politics of Cultural Memory, 1910 to 1945, 1989, and Revolutionary Memory, Recovering the Poetry of the American Left, 2001. For years, he's been engaged in elucidating and preserving America's progressive political and literary heritage. He has also sought to put his political ideals into practice as a tireless defender of academic freedom and as an advocate for the rights of marginalized groups within the teaching profession. His books, Academic Keywords, A Devil's Dictionary for Higher Education, 1999, Office Hours, Activism and Change in the Academy, 2004, No University is an Island, Saving Academic Freedom, 2010, and perhaps most famously, Manifesto of a Tenured Radical of 1997, have taken courageous stances on such subjects as the casualization of academic labor and the corporatization of the American university. The winner of numerous fellowships and awards, Cary Nelson served as the president of the AAUP, the American Association of University Professors, from 2006 to 2010. Over the last year, the movement to boycott Israel has been gaining steam. When the American Studies Association voted in favor of an academic boycott of Israel this fall, and when the Modern Language Association, of which we are both members, hosted a panel in support of the boycott at its annual convention last month, I realized that the Yale Program for the Study of Antisemitism needed to address this important issue as soon as possible. Cary Nelson's remarkable editorial in the Wall Street Journal on January 8th opposing the boycott convinced me that he was the ideal speaker because of the cogency of his arguments, but also because they were framed within a discourse of academic freedom that no scholar today has thought more deeply about or has more experience defending. I realize this is an extremely controversial issue, one which those in the audience today no doubt feel very passionately about. I hope that Professor Nelson's talk will stimulate debate, but urge that whatever discussion follows be conducted in a calm and respectful manner. The title of Professor Nelson's talk today is The Problem with Judith Butler, The Political Philosophy of the Movement to Boycott Israel. So please join me in welcoming Cary Nelson.
Thanks so much, Maury, and for making this opportunity possible for me to expose you to some of these ideas, but also this is very much a talk in progress. I'm still working on it, so I'm interested in what people's reactions to it are and what I can learn from you, so I hope we'll have a chance to do some of that during the audience discussion. When American Studies Association President Curtis F. Marez gave his absurd, "You've got to start somewhere," answer to a New York Times reporter's question of why one should single out Israel's universities for a boycott, one might have thought that he had set the gold standard for empty boycott advocacy. But soon a still more vacuous contestant arrived. At the pro-boycott session on January 9th at the Modern Language Association's 2014 annual meeting, University of Texas professor and panelist Barbara Harlow offered her own concise answer to the question, why boycott Israel? And her answer was, why not? With advocates like these, one might have thought the boycott, divestment, and sanctions movement, BDS, against Israel would need no opponents. But the boycott movement does have more skilled spokespersons at its disposal. Judith Butler, who has become the movement's premier philosopher and political theorist, is perhaps the foremost among them. Her work, which carries significant authority, especially amongst humanists, helps us get to the heart of BDS movement's primary principles. I think I should state first that I believe that Butler is very sincere in advocating for the positions she's taken, and I completely believe that her journey toward boycott advocacy has been a difficult and trying one. BDS supporters of academic boycotts tend to repeat the same factually disproven arguments, often ignoring counter evidence. Foremost of these is the central claim that a boycott of Israeli universities targets institutions, not individuals. Yet in his Modern Language Association panel presentation, Omar Bargoti conceded that individual faculty members would indeed often pay a price in an academic boycott. He simply said the price is worth it. It's disappointing, then, that Butler, in a December 2013 column in The Nation, retained the mantra of denial, again asserting that BDS targets institutions, not individuals. It may well be that she believes this. I know that she has friends who teach in Tel Aviv, including a progressive photographer and a filmmaker who focus on West Bank subjects, so I think it's unreasonable to imagine that Judith Butler wants to undermine their professional freedoms. Yet that's exactly what a boycott resolution will do. Her December column, the lecture she gave at Brooklyn College that was in The Nation, and her 2012 book, Parting Ways, Jewishness and the Critique of Zionism, are her major pro-boycott pieces, and they're the ones I'm going to be talking about here. Although Butler says that a boycott would deny Israeli faculty the right to use Israeli university funds to travel to conferences in the U.S., she reassures us they would be free to, quote, pay from their own personal funds. That's not a very realistic option for most of them, given that many Israeli faculty have relatively low salaries. The fact that they are still free to make the trip enables her to announce solemnly that the only version of BDS that can be defended is one that's compatible with the principles of academic freedom. Once again, I think we confront a striking BDS contradiction. ASA leaders naturally object to any effort to prohibit universities from funding member travel to ASA meetings. Both the AAUP and certainly I myself consider such prohibitions to be clear violations of academic freedom, so we agree. And the basic thing is, either you honor this principle comprehensively, opposing any political litmus tests on scholarly travel, or it won't be honored at all. Those legislatures or pro-Israeli organizations advocating ideological restrictions on state-funded faculty travel should realize, as a long-term view will tell you, that as political winds shift, these punitive measures will target their own constituencies. But travel is not the only serious limitations faculty would face. A significant number of American, Israeli, and Palestinian faculty are involved in interinstitutional research projects funded both by their own universities and by grants that the universities administer. These critical collaborations would collapse under a boycott regime if it were enforced. Butler says she has, quote, no problem collaborating with Israeli scholars and artists as long as we do not participate in any Israeli institution or have Israeli state monies support our collaborative work. I mean, let's just put it simply, refusing such financial support is a good deal easier for a philosopher than a scientist or an engineer. It's an unrealistic stance for anyone in a STEM field. Academic freedom includes the right to pursue the research of your choice, including collaborative research, and it includes the right to pursue the funding necessary for that work. Butler dismisses the limitations a boycott would impose as mere inconvenience, but faculty members who find their collaborative research projects on desalinization or solar energy torpedoed are certainly to use stronger language. Then she generates an unnecessary contradiction by claiming, quote, and here I believe she's quite wrong, academic freedom can only be exercised when the material conditions for exercising those rights are secured, which means that infrastructural rights are part of academic freedom. So, in reality, academic freedom protects your right to seek infrastructural support, but it doesn't guarantee you will get infrastructural support. A physicist who cannot find the money to buy a linear accelerator has not had his or her academic freedom violated. But then the inconvenience remark refers to constraints on Israelis, whereas her extension of academic freedom to funding addresses constraints on Palestinians. Meanwhile, Israelis are to be selectively denied one of the most common forms of infrastructural support, namely travel funds. Butler frequently fails to apply a principle like this in an even-handed fashion, or to distinguish between an abstract statement and its practical effects, a problem, as we will see, that I think influences all her writing on BDS. Butler and other BDS loyalists in the United States also seem not to understand that you can't control the consequences of a political movement by putting a couple of sentences in a resolution or a manifesto. This is what we believe, that is what we believe. These things play themselves out in the public sphere in quite unpredictable ways. Okay. Justice as an ahistorical abstraction. Foremost amongst Butler's strategies in all her pro-boycott work, and central to her appeal and success here, is the deployment of an abstract, universalizing concept of justice detached from any serious contextual challenges. In Deconstructing Israel, a January 2014 review published in German, Stephen Grigot points out that her main strategy is to mobilize an abstract and ahistorical universalism against all the historical particularities of Zionism. Yet the main particularities she does cite are Israeli-imposed injustices suffered by Palestinians. But nothing really happens to the concept of justice itself in her work on the Middle East. So, because I've read her work over many years, I have trouble accepting this abstract notion of justice as being deployed by the author of Gender Trouble, a book I have long admired, a book I have taught repeatedly, and whose model of gender as socially and historically constructed and thus learned and performed, I've pretty much completely internalized. I don't even think of it as a theory. I think of it as the truth. It's part of my belief system now. While gender and justice are concepts that operate in different registers, both are socially and historically constructed. An abstract notion of justice can serve as a social good, and it can hail people's sense of identity and their patterns of behavior. But it really has no place in discussions of the Middle East without historically based qualifications. Like other BDS advocates, Butler takes political self-determination as an unqualified good, a form of justice for Palestinians, an end result that then becomes a sine qua non for any acceptable resolution of the conflict. Anything less than that, she believes, will simply not constitute justice. And Americans on the left like to believe they stand firmly on the side of justice and prefer that not get too complicated. Like other proponents, she avoids serious reflection on what would constitute political self-determination for Israelis, save for the implication that Israeli hearts can never really be at peace until Palestinians have secured all their wishes. That, however, is precisely what cannot be achieved in a just resolution of the conflict. For too many Palestinians, justice means Palestinian sovereignty throughout the land between the Mediterranean and the Jordan River, a dream that perhaps too many Israelis share in reverse in the form of ambitions for a greater Israel, though it's probably not a majority view in Israel any longer. If peace is to be achieved, many on both sides will have to relinquish a model of justice designed to benefit only one party to the negotiations. So would Butler, if she were to imagine a solution adapted to political realities, which I don't think she has. Everyone is going to have to settle for less than they imagine justice to entail, for neither the Palestinians nor the Israelis will give up their own independent ambitions for sovereignty. Both sides will have to settle for less land over which their sovereignty will reign. The territorial compromises will have to include some way of establishing a Palestinian capital in East Jerusalem. For some Jews, that's a betrayal of a legacy at once religious and historical, a betrayal, therefore, of their notion of justice. Yet Jerusalem has evolved into a city with interwoven working relationships between Arabs and Jews and with public services that crisscross any conceivable boundaries. Some local cooperation is going to be necessary. We thus get nowhere by holding aloft a lantern called justice and letting it blind us to the complexities of culture, history, and national desire, along with the realities of economic and social integration. That lantern also blinds Butler to the diversity of Palestinian experience and desire. As Shayla Benhabib writes, the number of Arab youth who now are now perfectly bilingual is growing, and along with it, their political capacity to engage Israeli society directly. Many Palestinian Arabs living in occupied East Jerusalem would much rather become Israeli citizens in an open and gender egalitarian society than live under an Islamist rule or of a party. That's at least one reason why Butler cannot simply assert that non-Jewish Israeli citizens fundamentally feel unhappily bound to a specific and controversial, if not contradictory, notion of democracy. Butler's decontextualized abstract notion of justice also helps her give unqualified literal endorsement to the Palestinian right of return to reside in Israel. But an unqualified right of return policy means the end of the Jewish state. It may be possible to endorse a qualified right of return as an abstract principle, not as a way literally to return to Israel, but as a way to regain something of what was lost, to acknowledge that wrongs were done, and to confirm some version of belated compensation, while fully admitting that actual physical return cannot possibly be put into practice. Affirmation of the principle then becomes symbolic, a form of historical witness. Butler, however, cannot reliably negotiate distinctions between an abstraction and the complexities of social life. And in truth, many Palestinians want the right of return as a way to leverage the demographics of the Israeli state. So the symbolic statement would only work if it clearly was accepted that way as part of a negotiated agreement. It is not possible, Butler argues, to restrict the problem of Palestinian subjugation to the occupation alone. Some confidently claim that if Israel unilaterally abandoned much of the West Bank, a solution, I think, may be not only morally and politically necessary, but also inevitable, abandoning, simply withdrawing from the West Bank, if Israel is to save the soul of its democracy by freeing itself of an internal subject population. Some think, well, if Israel did that, BDS would lose its raison d'etre and would quickly wither away as an organization. But everything Butler says argues for the opposite outcome. For her, so long as the children and the grandchildren and extended families of Palestinians who once lived within Israel's 1948 borders cannot return to surviving homes, she believes, so long as they cannot return to rebuild villages raised in 1948 or later, justice will not be served. Contrarily, it is entirely possible, politically possible, and logically possible, to confine the problem of Palestinian subjugation to the West Bank. She doesn't like that possibility, but that does not in and of itself make it logically or politically impossible. Subjugation, moreover, hardly describes the status of Palestinian citizens within Israeli proper. Whatever inequalities affect Israel's Arab citizens could more readily be resolved if the threat of a Palestinian majority were taken out of the equation. But Butler and too many other BDS supporters insist that the threat of a Palestinian majority must become a reality, just as it remains a sacred principle for Palestinian political groups. Unilateral withdrawal from the West Bank is not likely to involve abandoning all settlements. First of all, because I think it would be politically impossible to do so absent an agreement, because it would leave Palestinians no incentive to negotiate further, and because Israel would face serious security risks. Nor would partial withdrawal relieve Israel of all international pressure. But it would separate Israel from large numbers of Palestinians, and it would end the injustices that many Palestinians face. That would change the nature of and the basis for international protest, and it would undercut the popular left claim that Israel is a colonialist power. Internal resistance to that course of action has increased because many Israelis feel the withdrawal from Gaza has been less than a rousing success, given what Gaza has become. Negative developments include the culmination of the struggle between Fatah and Hamas and the Hamas victory in 2007, the continuing series of rocket attacks on Israel, and such cultural changes in Gaza as the imposition of limitations on women's rights, none of which the BDS movement seems to feel fit to criticize, nor has Butler. In a 2006 Q&A at UC Berkeley teach-in, Butler remarked that, quote, understanding Hamas, Hezbollah as social movements that are progressive, that are on the left, as are part of a global left, is extremely important. Her modest qualification, quote, that does not stop us from being critical of certain dimensions of both movements, does not really undercut the basic claim, and she's had plenty of opportunity to modify or detract this statement had she wished to do so. Despite all of that, in my view, Israel is still better off without Gaza than with it. And that model, I think, is likely, I don't see, you know, maybe negotiations will succeed, but I think people have to face a similar kind of withdrawal as a possibility from the West Bank. Now, of course, the context for Butler and for others in the US is different from that for Palestinians and Israelis. She is not prey to a desire to live in an ancestral family home in Tel Aviv. Clinging instead to a distinctly American politics based on an idealist fantasy of historical possibility. She holds out the ideal, quite, of a just and peaceable form of coexistence, a place beyond war. But that place for her has a name, Greater Palestine, and it has a people in command, Palestinians. This peaceable kingdom fantasy of a binational state in which everyone just gets along has great appeal to the American left, which partly explains Butler's immense political appeal. It's an abstract, idealist solution underwritten by Edward Said's equally unrealistic observation toward the end of his life that Israelis and Palestinians are both diasporic peoples whose parallel histories should generate compatibility, that neither Middle Eastern politics nor history can actually deliver. Are Jews who have lived all their lives in Israel supposed to have inherited their diasporic souls genetically? Or did they acquire this identity by listening to stories of their grandparents' lives? Butler's fantasy notion that Israeli Jews would willingly submit to Arab rule is grounded in yet another hypothetical piece of invented diasporic psychology. Quote, one of the most important ethical dimensions of the diasporic Jewish tradition, namely the obligation of cohabitation with those different from ourselves. In Parting Ways, as Bain Habib points out, Butler develops her distinctive notion of cohabitation as an ethical imperative from a reading of Hannah Arendt. Quote, this is a strange attempt to interpolate Arendt for Butler's own social ontology via the use of terms such as cohabitation that are not Arendt's at all. It's an effort to tease out what she calls a principle out of Arendt's text. This may be Butler, Bain Habib concludes, but it's certainly not Arendt. Arendt writes of plurality and not of plural cohabitation. Most importantly, I'd add, you know, Arendt considered plurality part of the human condition, not something particular to the diasporic experience of Jews. I think it's astonishing that Said himself believed this tenuous level of identity, a diasporic history, could sustain a shared national allegiance, especially given that the Palestinians happened to blame the Israelis for their diasporic condition. But perhaps, as Butler suggests, Said was just conducting a thought experiment. Of course, there's a certain kind of theorist who doesn't readily distinguish between a thought experience, a thought experiment, and a policy proposal. Butler's own analysis does not embody history. Instead, it's divorced from it and presents a grave danger were it to become a centerpiece of US foreign policy. Meanwhile, it represents a delusional form of false consciousness for American students and faculty. There is a signal moment in Butler's 2013 Nation essay, easy to overlook, where we can see the price a frustrated idealist can exact when real bodies embedded in history are subjected to an idealist gaze. It's when she engages those, quote, smaller forms of binational cultural communities in which Israeli Jews and Palestinians live and work together. There have been local realities of this sort over the last century in Palestine, and they persist in some places and contexts today, despite the wave of nationalist sentiment that swept through Palestinian communities in the 20s and 30s, and that, I think, transformed the conflict ever thereafter. What is astonishing and disturbing in Butler's analysis is that she finds the lives of such people involved in local cooperation communities inadequate and unacceptable unless they take on the larger oppositional agenda she wants to promote. She displays the frustrated impatience utopians on both the left and the right have shown many times when people in local communities are satisfied to live their lives as they see fit. The only question, she writes, is whether these small communities continue to accept the oppressive structure of the state or whether in their small and effective way oppose the various dimensions of subjugation and disenfranchisement. Coexistence, then, is insufficient, misguided, lacking, unless it matures to join, quote, solidarity struggles. Coexistence becomes solidarity when it joins the movement that seeks to undo the structural conditions of inequality, containment, and dispossession. So, discontent with those uninterested in reshaping their lives to fit an overarching political agenda not infrequently produces intolerance and violent strategies, leaving millions dead in the USSR in the 1930s and again decades later in Cambodia. What is one to do in the end when people just not will not listen to those who know better? They will need to be re-educated. It will require a cultural revolution. Butler makes much of the nonviolent character of the BDS movement. It's only, quote, it's the only credible nonviolent mode of resisting the injustices committed by the State of Israel. And I suppose she believes that because BDS works through discourse and protest, it's nonviolent. And it is nonviolent as a fantasy structure. She invokes this fantasy when she protests that BDS is not the same as Hamas. Of course, they aren't the same. BDS is a political movement, and Hamas is at least partly an armed terrorist group, though its role in Gaza has led it to provide social services as well. Like it or not, however, the BDS movement and Hamas share the same goal, the elimination of the Jewish state. And Hamas has hardly embraced nonviolence. BDS and Hamas are conceptually and politically linked, even though Butler and BDS assume a peaceful transition to majority Palestinian rule is plausible. The Jews give up the State of Israel, and with it all their religious and political commitments, and submit to a Palestinian majority. I haven't heard the related left fantasy for some years, for obvious reasons, but before suicide bombers visited Israeli cities and crude Qassam rockets arrived from Gaza, leftists sometimes characterized Palestinians as uniquely peace-loving and gentle amongst all the peoples of the earth. On the American left, we like to project our fantasies of extra-human virtue onto political victims, but doing so makes them something other than what they are. Nonetheless, there's a remnant of that celebratory left dichotomy in what Bain Habib describes as Butler's, quote, simple equivalence between rationalism, the sovereign subject, Eurocentrism, and Zionist colonialism. Opposed to this outdated epistemology of mastery is what Butler sees as a blameless, anti-colonialist Palestinian resistance movement. But, as Bain Habib adds, we know that anti-colonial movements are not always emancipatory, and that political action in the name of oppressed peoples can also carry the seeds of oppression within it. Butler, she concludes, seems beholden to an anti-imperialist jargon of the politics of purity. Butler sustains the relative purity of the opposition in part by minimalizing its anti-Semitism. Quote, some forms of Palestinian opposition do rely on anti-Semitic slogans, falsehoods, and threats, she writes, and all these forms of anti-Semitism are to be unconditionally opposed. Sounds good. Thus, she reduces Palestinian anti-Semitism to a rhetorical strategy, trivializing its significance and discounting what many Israelis know to be true, that anti-Semitism sometimes represents deep-seated conviction. It does little good to denounce slogans confidently when what you're actually confronting is long-nurtured hatred and resentment, as if Palestinians, by censuring their language, could decisively reform their feelings as well. nor does it help to address anti-Semitic impulses within BDS philosophy by defensive denial, countering, quote, "it would appear that no oppositional move can take place without risking the accusation of anti-Semitism." Israel is surrounded by undemocratic regimes, intolerant of religious diversity. It's a conflicted democracy with serious problems. But Israel proper, save the West Bank, is a remarkably free society by any comparison with its neighbors. So one may fairly wonder why American BDS followers single it out as a rogue state. Is one left with the flippant "why not" response? Dialogue with someone who argues that any criticism of Israeli policy amounts to anti-Semitism is probably impossible. But a defense of the BDS movement that defends its challenges to Israel's very existence with a blanket denial of anti-Semitism is no better than its more extreme opposition. In the end, one and only one thing makes it possible to isolate Israel conceptually and politically from all other nations: anti-Semitism. It's the long and abiding international history of anti-Semitism that makes Israel not only available to be singled out, but also always already othered, set apart. An opposition to Israel provides anti-Semitism with its contemporary intellectual and moral credibility. Anti-Zionism is anti-Semitism's moral salvation. Its perfect disguise, its route to legitimation. Arguments about whether a given opponent is or is not anti-Semitic are thus necessarily, at least in part, irrelevant. In that light, denial counts as affirmation. Thus, Barbara Harlow's seemingly idiotic answer, "why not," actually speaks to the existential reality. Why not single out the country that already stands alone in our minds? Indeed, it stands alone in the minds of Jews and non-Jews alike. Some Jews, including some who testify in the Bruce Robbins film, "Some of My Best Friends Are Zionists," experience an overwhelming need to expel Israel from themselves, to convince both themselves and everyone else that they do not harbor Israel within. I think that helps explain the intensity with which some Jews reject the very existence of an Israeli state. And yet for Jews, Israel always seems encapsulated, warded off within. So their passion for expelling it escalates. It's a dynamic and progressive process. The well-known accusation of Jewish self-hatred is thus a simplification and a slander. If they hate, they only hate a part of themselves and fear it as well. It's anti-Semitism alone, it's critical to realize, that makes it possible to castigate Israel on grounds on which it is the same as other countries, not different. Worse still, that sameness applies only to cultural and political categories, not to responsible fact-based comparisons. The sameness would be these kinds of things. Israel discriminates against segments of those under control. Israel is a religious state, and we object to religious states on principle. Israel's warrant to exist as a nation state implicates power dynamics, not some inevitable destiny. Other populations believe they have equal or greater right to the land. Israel's borders have not remained the same since its founding. Israel's human rights record in areas over which it exercises control is far from perfect. All of these apply to the United States in one way or another. All these concerns are less applicable to Israel than to more than a score of other countries in the Middle East and elsewhere. Yet Israel alone is considered a pariah among nations by BDS advocates. It's no surprise, moreover, that BDS advocates discount both past and future violence against Israel, and that anti-Semitism, in the end, makes it possible to do so. Everything that might be done to a group of Jews has already been done, has already happened. Such violence is not a risk, it's an historical given. In the context of celebrating BDS nonviolence, Butler also rejects as categorically absurd the accusation that BDS rhetoric is a form of hate speech. She also rejects the argument that hers and other BDS arguments have, quote, "spawned a set of variations that include hate speech directed against either the state of Israel or Israeli Jews." certainly I agree that rational arguments against Israeli policy do not constitute hate speech. There can be no meaningful political dialogue unless people are free to criticize a nation's policies. The problem arises with Barghoutis, Butlers, and other BDS advocates' intense and unqualified rejection of the Jewish state, and with all the moral outrage they direct toward Israel. That moral outrage is not directed toward Israeli policy alone. It could be, and that would be fair. It's an existential and political rejection of Israel's right to exist. It's filled with hostility, and it does encourage more inflamed rhetoric that crosses the line into hate speech, and hate speech can and does promote violence. Suffice it to say that there is no nonviolent way to transition to Judith Butler's peaceable kingdom, and no reason either to suppose the kingdom would end up being peaceable. Is it possible, she asked in Brooklyn, that words might bring about a general ethos of violence? As a political theory, that speculation and the BDS goal she offers for Palestine has no relation to reality. It's a fantasy that can only play out in violence. However nonviolence the fantasy is in intent, therefore it could only be violent in effect. That said, I am convinced that Butler believes this stuff. While she may have been merely performative in her lead-in to the Nation piece, I believe she had drunk her own Kool-Aid by the end. My wager, my hope, she writes, is that everyone's chance to live with greater freedom from fear and aggression will be increased as these conditions of justice, freedom, and equality are realized. At that point, feelings of ecstatic self-love sweep over the American audience and the applause rises. They can imagine themselves to have entered what she calls, quote, that ecstatic relationality, a way of being comported beyond oneself, a way of being dispossessed from sovereignty and nation, end quote, that she invokes repeatedly in parting ways. Of course, that fantasy, that illusion of a move beyond nation is one that American exceptionalism and power has made possible for its citizens to partake of. It would not find such a warm reception in the Middle East. Although those who have not read Basic Histories of Israel may not realize it, Butler does invoke exactly the right context for discussions of the origins of the Arab-Israeli conflict. She realizes that the incompatible claims of 1948 still underlie positions today. Unfortunately, she overlays those competing claims with the absolutist moral stance that dominates BDS discourse. Instead of acknowledging that competing claims for national identity and sovereignty over the land, she contrasts, quote, the Israeli demand for demographic identity to, quote, the multivalent forms of dispossession that affect Palestinians. In other words, what are in fact parallel but competing nationalist and religious ambitions are transformed into a simple binary of Israeli dominance and Palestinian subservience. The history of the Jewish people in the land of Israel, the land's connection to Judaism, all this has no meaning for her. She simply, quote, eschews the Zionist linkage of nation to land. Instead of seeing the conflict as one between two peoples with indigenous ties to the land, she credits only one. Justice is all on one side, and the conflict is to be resolved by granting the Palestinians everything they wanted from the outset, from the moment that war broke out on November 30, 1947. In parting ways, Butler explicitly lists the massive dispossessions of Palestinians in 1948 as one of the wrongs that must be righted. Indeed, she goes on to say that Israel has been built on a series of land confiscations that preceded 1948. A very frank discussion of violence on both sides may be found in Benny Morris's 1948, The First Arab-Israeli War. For Butler, not only are the 1967 borders illegitimate, and she's quite clear about this, there are no legitimate borders, not 1948, not 1936, not 1909. She believes that a fully ethical Judaism would lead one to reject the whole existence of a Jewish state, not just its policies. Does she really think she can preach that sermon to Jews worldwide with a commitment to a Jewish state, let alone to Israelis themselves? If not, then what is the audience for this argument, and what would their motives be for endorsing it? Butler disparages, quote, the football lingo of being pro-Palestinian and anti-Israeli. This language is reductive, if not embarrassing, she writes. But what her decontextualized and ahistorical notion of justice allows her to do is to duplicate exactly that dichotomy by way of a moral economy of right and wrong. Repairing all the components of Israeli injustice then becomes the one priority and the only goal for the region. And we are assured that the result, quite, might one day become a just and peaceable form of coexistence if we create a state with a Palestinian majority, a state that, by its very nature, grants justice to only one of the parties in the equation. Butler, in fact, maintains that justice only inheres in the Palestinian cause. For her, there's no valid case to be made for Israelis as citizens of a Jewish state. In the rhetorical economy of her work, there are no competing arguments. It's a conflict between truth and error. The model provides no basis for either negotiation or compromise. It foresees only a basis for continuing struggle and eventual Israeli capitulation. Worse still, whatever willingness Butler herself might have to discuss these matters does not carry over to the BDS movement as a whole. They accept the logic that transforms parallel claims into a moral opposition of right and wrong, infecting BDS discourse with a presumptive sense of moral superiority that simply need not be examined further. If you sign on to BDS discourse, you sign on to its conclusions. You do not need to think any further. And that's why I think Butler's Brooklyn College invitation to a dialogue is in reality somewhat disingenuous. The BDS movement is not interested in reflection or conversation. The fraction of the American left that's adopted the BDS mantra thus revels in the confidence they are in the right, whereas the only real hope for peace lies in a cold recognition that the opposing forces can only be accommodated by stable, negotiated forms of partition. BDS discourse, of course, can only sustain this moral absolutism by erecting a series of prohibitions. Prohibitions against speaking the words that must be spoken if honest discussion and debate are to proceed. There is, first of all, the virtual prohibition against mention of Palestinian violence. Butler gives no attention to and shows no concern about the effect on Israelis of a series of suicide bombings whose victims have included both Jews and Palestinians, along with threats from Arab and non-Arab states in the region, Iran being the most worrisome. If she talked to someone who escaped an explosion at a favorite cafe by a few moments, she might feel differently. Then there's the prohibition against granting any legitimacy to the concept of a Jewish state, along with the prohibition against admitting what the fate of Jews would be in an Arab-dominated state. And finally, there is the third rail of all U.S. debate over oppositions to Israel, once again, the role of anti-Semitism. As Robert Wittreich writes in his contribution to Rosenfeld's recent collection, Resurgent Antisemitism, even to raise the issue is considered by leftists and some liberals too an act of Zionist intellectual terrorism designed primarily to silence justified opposition toward Israel. In an effort to counter this strategy, faculty here and abroad have been working to turn the issue of anti-Semitism in anti-Israeli groups from a prohibited topic into a valid subject for academic research and analysis, and I think they've made some notable progress in the last couple of years. As I suggested above, it is not that, quote, any and all criticism of the state of Israel is anti-Semitic. The sad defensive position that Butler unnecessarily debunks, but that any solution that involves dismantling the Jewish state is anti-Semitic in effect and fueled, as Butler seems not to understand, at least obliquely, by anti-Semitic traditions that make the needs of a long dispossessed people, the Jews, either secondary or expendable. But many BDS advocates simply become agitated when the subject is broached, especially in conversation. Meanwhile, branding suggestions that Jews would fare poorly under Arab nationalism and Muslim fundamentalism as themselves irrational. In addition to its prohibitions, BDS has an epithet of choice, Zionist. Butler helps solidify that epithet as Alan Johnson points out in a review of Parting Ways, by creating what Marx would have called an ahistorical, eternal, fixed, and abstract conception of the history of Zionism and Israel, from which is missing actual experience and real emergence, from which has been erased all concrete differences between periods of Israeli history, between different wings of Zionism, between different political parties within Israel, between different Israeli social classes. There are other Zionisms in her account, but they aren't constitutive of the monolithic Israeli state she has constructed. Indeed, though she acknowledges the singular history of Jewish oppression, her theory of Jewish identity relies on the same unitary model of Jewish history, homogenizing it as a rich broth exhibiting multiple forms of cohabitation with non-Jews. That leaves all Jews, though some would be surprised to learn it, with identities founded, quote, as Butler writes, in an impurity, a mixing with otherness, an ineradicable alterity. Butler makes the absurd demand, in fact, fully in play for over a century, that historiographical presumption of progressive history that supports the idea of Zionism as the unfolding realization of an ideal can and must be countered by a critique of that form of progressivism. Has anyone read any reliable history of Israel? She could start with Anita Shapira's Israeli History. The history of Zionism is complex, and different Zionists often had competing and contradictory aims and beliefs. But now it seems mere belief in the validity of a Jewish state can be belittled as a Zionist obsession, often with the implied slander that Zionism equals racism. That is certainly where a portion of the American left, including a portion of the Jewish left, now stands. American Jews young enough to have grown up feeling fully assimilated find the controversy over Israel increasingly uncomfortable. It sets them apart, others them within the left in ways they've never experienced before. And so they seek sometimes to rejoin their comrades by paying the only price that's acceptable, defining the occupation as the very existence of the Jewish state and implicitly advocating its delegitimation and dissolution. Butler gives them the arguments they need to persuade themselves that process could be nonviolent. In clinging to that illusion, they join a long and troubled tradition of Jews who flee their heritage out of fear and a desire for acceptance and assimilation. In Parting Ways, Butler makes it clear that for Israeli Jews, this would entail, quote, an obligatory passage beyond identity and nation as defining frameworks, end quote, so as to conceive, quote, complex and antagonistic modes of living together, unquote. She compares it to a family that fights over things. Well, when a family has millions of people in it and it's subject to political movements that are a little more disputatious and a little better armed than most American families, although when American families are armed, it gets in trouble then too, then that fantasy doesn't really work. Palestinians, a subjugated people, are apparently not required to abandon nationalism. Toward the end of Parting Ways, she poses this as a question, quote, do we want to oppose the nationalism of those who have yet to see a state, of the Palestinians who are still seeking to gather a nation, to establish a nation state for the first time? No, we'd want to oppose Jewish nationalism, but not Palestinian nationalism. What Butler, in a gesture of extraordinary arrogance, actually means is that binationalism requires Israeli Jews not only to cease being Israeli, but also to cease being Jews. The history of both European and Arab anti-Semitism, as we will remember, includes no few examples of such advice delivered in more violent rhetoric with more violent effect. In that light, Butler's demand for an indefinite moratorium on the law of return in Israel that gives Jews worldwide the right to emigrate to Israel may seem almost modest. Since Israel is not a legitimate state, why should it have a right to an immigration policy? Stripped of its drama, that's really all the right of return is, an immigration policy with a religious preference established by a religious state, a state, however, in which other religions flourish. Where Butler is correct, and painfully so, is asserting that there never was a possibility for a Jewish state in Palestine without the dispossession of Arab lands. What she doesn't trouble herself to confront is the fact that Jews purchased some land prior to 1936 that was owned by wealthy Arabs, often living elsewhere, and that some, but not all, tenant farmers lost their right to live there as a result. Other areas were settled peacefully. Nor in confronting the genuine tragedy of 1948 is she much interested in acknowledging that a series of Arab states launched a war against Israel that year. But the fact remains that Palestinians lost their homes and saw their communities destroyed. Displaced Palestinians should have been offered reconstruction of their villages on other Arab lands at the time. The U.S. should have offered to cover much of the cost, but that option has been swallowed in the sands of time. Also missing, at least from her account, is the fact that a comparable number of Jews were forced out of their ancestral homes in Arab lands as a consequence of the establishment of Israel. They and their descendants make up the majority of Israeli Jews today. I trust readers will understand why they are not demanding a right of return to the Arab states from which they fled or were let out. Does one find BDS supporters sympathizing with Arab Jews who lost their homes, their lands, and their businesses? Not as far as I know. Do they call on Arab governments for reparations? Why is it that justice doesn't include full justice for those displaced Jews? For many Arab Jews, it was not the Holocaust they had to flee, but rather the risk of a similar fate at Arab hands. If the creation of Israel intensified Arab anti-Semitism, it also gave Arab Jews a haven and a home. Justice for them would not be enhanced by dismantling that home. What can be made available as part of an agreement without destruction of the State of Israel is fair financial compensation to Palestinian families displaced in 1948. As part of its commitment to creating two viable states in the region, the U.S. can shoulder most of that cost, with Israel contributing according to its ability. Whilst few seem to like to admit it, the relevance of a literal right of return has diminished as Palestinian adults living within Israel's 1967 borders at the time have aged and died. It's likely that fewer than 10% of those who fled or were expelled in 1948 remain alive. Many of those were very young children at the time. The right of later generations to return to a home they've never seen or to a village that no longer exists seems at best chimerical. The principle is less a human right than a political weapon. Its emotional valence, to be sure, has been sustained by prolonged life in the refugee camps during which Palestinians felt they had no home with a future. As Amir Ahas, an Israeli critic of our country's policies, have acknowledged, quote, with the passing of years, as many first-generation refugees age and die, the return home becomes increasingly transtemporal, meta-real. The sense of loss is thus metaphysical, not material, and can be unlearned, especially if other benefits and possibilities balance it. But a Palestinian state on the West Bank would be free to adopt its own immigration policy. Once again, Butler deploys her abstract notion of justice to decry the contradiction between a right of return denied for Palestinians and a law of return affirmed for Jews. It's a contradiction, but one that Israel must sustain if it's to remain a Jewish entity. As United States history might have led Butler to acknowledge when she states in parting ways that no democratic polity has the right to secure demographic advantage for any particular ethnic or religious group, what she might have remembered is that some democratic polities, including our own, have done precisely that. Such rights are partly a function of historical circumstance and relative power. She points out a doubt that a UN resolution affirms the Palestinian right of return, but then a UN resolution established the State of Israel as well. That said, divested of the West Bank, Israel could make certain that no legal forms of discrimination persist within its borders. Legal means are readily available to bar discrimination in areas like housing, employment, and municipal services, and Israel must strengthen them to protect its Jewish minorities as well as its Palestinian citizens. Symbolic issues, the flag, the national anthems, they will still mark difference. but the benefits of a democratic society can counterbalance them. In other words, if what Butler actually wants is that the state of Israel consider taking formal acts by which equality might be more inclusively allocated and to contemporary forms of discrimination, differential violence, and daily harassment against the Palestinian people be brought to an end, then Jews need neither to ground their identities in diaspora nor dissolve their nation. They need to reform their laws to foster equality internally, and they need to abandon the bulk of the West Bank so the Palestinians living there can govern themselves. To be a refugee, to be stateless, indeed is an unacceptable condition, but that doesn't mean Palestinian refugees need to live in Tel Aviv. Despite these problems with Butler's unreservedly idealist agenda, I want to conclude that I acknowledge that she believes in her, quote, single state, one that would eradicate all forms of discrimination on the basis of ethnicity, race, and religion. The problem is that no major players in the Middle East believe that goal is realistic, and most actually have no interest in it. When Palestinian political groups announce that they acknowledge the existence of Israel, they refer to a place where Jews and Arabs live. They don't typically intend to affirm Israel's right to exist as a Jewish state. As Benny Morris argues in One State, Two States, Palestinian insistence on the right of return is, quote, code for the elimination of Israel and the conquest of all of Palestine. Other than wishful thinking, Butler really has no answer to the challenge Morris offers to happy family prospects for the Middle East. Quote, what Muslim Arab society in the modern age has treated Christians, Jews, pagans, Buddhists, and Hindus with tolerance and as equals. Why should anyone believe that the Palestinian Muslim Arabs would behave any differently? Meanwhile, the troubling results of the Arab Spring confirm Morris's tough judgment that the Palestinian Arabs, like the world's other Muslim Arab communities, are deeply religious and have no traditions of democratic governance. In my own view, that doesn't mean Arab countries can't develop democratic institutions over time, but it does mean that a minority Israeli population will have reason to fear that neither their rights nor their physical security would be guaranteed in the critical first years of a binational state's existence. Does anyone actually think Israelis would willingly sign on to that risk? Is that what installing their diasporic history in their souls is supposed to do for them? By addressing only the most apocalyptic warnings about the risks of violence and calls for the abolition of the Jewish state, Butler is conveniently able to dismiss all lesser but still quite consequential risks of violence. If a BDS proponent argues that Israel is not a legitimate state, she complains, that's taken to be a genocidal position, a wish to see a given population annihilated. She can then come neatly to the conclusion that, quote, no thoughtful conditions about legitimacy can take place under such conditions. Except for her idiosyncratic theory that Jews should so thoroughly internalize their diasporic history that they are led to embrace statelessness, however, there's little reason to hope that anything other than a bloodbath would follow upon an attempt to dissolve the Jewish state. BDS advocates protest that that's an alarmist or hysterical response to a one-state proposal, but I think instead that it's coldly realistic. One might look at civil war, perhaps think Bosnia rather than Hiroshima. What Butler's BDS-style one-state solution would actually produce is a Muslim Arab-dominated state devoted to ethnic cleansing of the Jewish population. But Israelis would not go peacefully into that dark night. They would fight. At best, a civil war would ensue, leading to untold deaths of Jews and Palestinians and serious regional economic and humanitarian disasters. I do not accept a Holocaust analogy for the prospect of a one-state solution. But I do believe Butler's claims of a nonviolent route to a single state are at best naive and at worst genuinely dangerous. They bear no relation to reality. They demonstrate what happens when a brilliant theorist, and she is a brilliant theorist, turns to real-world politics she either does not or will not comprehend. The binationalism she advocates, she acknowledges, quote, is not love, But there is, we might say, a necessary, an impossible attachment that makes a mockery of identity, an ambivalence that emerges from the decentering of a national ethos and that forms the basis of a permanent ethical demand. Good luck with that. Does she think millions of Arabs and Jews are mere clay she can mold to fit her fantasy ambitions for them? Those who question where Butler's heedless pursuit of an abstract logic of justice would take us should read very carefully the sometimes oblique sentences she crafts. Toward the end of Parting Ways, she suggests that any relationship with the Jewish state is morally and politically unacceptable. Quote, Palestinians who have been forced to become diasporic should not have to contemplate even a colonial power that stays in place and out of sight. So think about this. According to her, the two-state solution would be psychologically and politically corrupted by the past. Palestinians would be living in juxtaposition with the embodiments of their former oppressors. Even if coexistence, she writes, requires working within the disavowed framework of colonial power, then colonial power becomes a precondition of coexistence. Following this logic, the establishment of a Palestinian state will do nothing to stop the ongoing tragedy of the Nakba, the catastrophe of Palestinian expulsions. For a Palestinian state would still bear within itself, be the product of, that foundation of eternally and intolerable expulsion. Butler's reasoning is quite strange at points. Quote, as the homogeneous nation moves forward, she writes, it continues to spit out and pile up those who are no longer supported by a history that would establish them as subjects. They are, rather, expelled from the nation as so much debris, indiscernible from a littered landscape. Now, quite apart from her indifference to those of Israel's Arab neighbors who have far more homogeneous societies than Israel, Butler's meaning here presumably cannot include the claim that Israel would expel its own Arab citizens in the wake of a formal two-state solution. Presumably what Butler means is not only that those who fled in 1948 or were expelled continued to live as victims of expulsion, that the present time continues to reenact the past, but also that any Palestinian who doesn't have free access to and choice of residence throughout Palestine lives in an intolerable condition of exile. In other words, in two states, they would still be exiled because they were exiled from their homes. They could never be at peace. Butler's solution, quote, the undoing of Israeli colonial power and military force. Setting aside her appalling tendency to forget that Israel includes millions of human beings, not just the mechanized colonial entity she's constructed in her mind, one may say simply that Butler has crafted a recipe for war. A certain studied indifference to Israel's citizens also informs her last abstract claim. Following the standard and explicit BDS effort to delegitimate the Israeli state, she argues, as Ehelian Yakira points out in his own contribution to resurgent anti-Semitism, quote, that Israel either never has been legitimate or that it's lost its legitimacy by its allegedly criminal behavior. What's odd about this argument, as Yakira elaborates, is that a nation's legitimacy is first of all established and sustained as a pact between a government and its citizens. And the citizens of Israel overwhelmingly want the Jewish state to persevere. From Butler's perspective, Israel's legitimacy can only be established by the true citizens, the Palestinian descendants of those who once lived there, most of whom do not live there now. They're the citizens, not the people in Israel. The citizens of Israel are elsewhere, and they can only establish justice. The numbers are such that Israeli Jews would have no say in their own country's future. For Butler, Israel would merely be, quote, changing the foundations of its legitimacy, the latter concept being Butler's contribution to the political logic of Mideast peace. In reality, hers and the BDS movement's first goal is to maximize international hostility toward Israel, a project destined to harden positions, not move the peace process along. In the real world, moreover, contrary to her utopian fantasy, history offers no guarantees. If what we actually seek is peace in the Middle East, we need to accept the need for Palestinian rights for self-determination within agreed-upon borders, to fair compensation for families displaced in 48 or 67, and to secure borders for a Jewish state. We can then work back from that goal to see what steps are most likely to lead us there. And working back from the goal is actually the way you have to think about Mideast peace. What will not help us move toward that goal is a BDS-inspired effort to demonize and delegitimate the state of Israel. If Butler is the best that BDS can offer in the way of a rational case for their cause, then her work is fundamentally flawed by its unmitigated hostility toward Israel. American academics instead might begin their own education by reading what Israeli historians and journalists have to say about their own country, a country and situation they know and understand. It's a country whose politics cannot be reduced to simple platitudes within a historical frame. Educated Americans should encourage respect for all parties. They should encourage enhanced empathy amongst those who lack it, and come to the recognition that no one is going to get to win everything in Palestine. Thank you.
Thank you for a very rich and complex talk that disturbing in many moments and with a lot to think about. So my question is, I've read a little bit of Butler, and I guess I don't understand what her argument is when it's pointed out that America has done terrible things before, and yet, you know, she's not saying that America has no right to exist as a state, or that America has no right to an immigration policy, or to, you know, and, you know, this idea that Palestinians can never live next to a state that did bad things to them. I mean, how, you know, start with the Native Americans here. I mean,
You'd have a long list of states on this planet that would be, incompatible with that condition.
Yeah. But I'm just trying to, what is her response to that? I'm not asking you to ventriloquize her, but how does she respond to that?
By and large, the BDS movement has these kind of responses. This is the problem we confront now. That is, we confront an imposition of unjust conditions in the present moment in Israel. We can't fix all prior wrongs. When you give talks in Canada, which I've done a number of times, they often begin the event by saying, please remember that we are standing on lands taken by violence from indigenous populations. And we ask their permission to speak today because it's really their country. And my standard response is, by the way, we don't say that in America, the United States, because we knew that we had God on our side when we dispossessed Native Americans. So I think there's, first of all, an unwillingness to make that comparative case. She's not willing to make the comparative case. And the practical argument is that the comparative case sort of has no bearing on decisions that the United States would make in the present moment. But I think that makes it possible to generate this moral absolute, that there's an injustice that transcends anything else that's in the world or that has happened in the world. And I think all moral absolutes require comparative analysis. I've stood with my colleague Michael Rothberg for years in saying those who say the Holocaust can't be compared to anything have to realize that if it's unique, that uniqueness is established by comparison. You can't have uniqueness without some comparative context. So, in fact, whatever's been done and continues to be done to Palestinians in the Middle East has to be thought through in a comparative context. You can't, but when you erect an absolute, which is what's happening, without that kind of comparison, you really have no basis for a rational politics. But the comparisons don't exist in BDS discourse. With one exception, actually. My one-time friend Dick Oman, who's a BDS supporter, does, now retired from Wesleyan, does often say we shouldn't boycott Israeli universities before we boycott American universities. They're complicit in state power. They're complicit in American militarism. We've got to boycott them as well. We could boycott both, but let's not just boycott those. And I must say Dick didn't take that position when he was still receiving a salary from Wesleyan, but he's taken it since retiring. And, you know, most people aren't too interested in boycotting the source of their income. He's really the only BDS person who's willing to sort of say, you know, we have wrongs in our past and present as well. Hi.
I'm not going to engage in the details of Butler's philosophy. I've done that in the review that you have cited. But I want to talk a little bit about the politics of the BDS movement, because I think that some of your arguments, for me, go a little far, because I think that boycotts are legitimate use weapons of struggle. They can be put to good use, but I want to reflect a little bit about what's going on right now. I think a lot of people are motivated by the analogy between Israel and South Africa, particularly for young people, and I've heard this also in Europe, in Great Britain. Israel is an apartheid state. There is no distinction between national struggle and racial struggles. There is racial discrimination within Israel. It will not do us any good to deny that.
Certainly. Okay?
So there is this analogy in people's heads, which is one thing that we have to start dealing with. And at that point, I think one has to go a little bit into history. I agree with you, the naivety is appalling. That's one thing. But the other thing is that people are desperate and impatient, and it is no use denying the boneheadedness of the Netanyahu government and the demographic changes in Israel, which have made it now impossible for moderate, you know, peace movement to ever have any voice. Israel has changed itself. And in my opinion, it has not changed for the good. It has created a center-right majority. Every time something happens, more territories are in fact occupied, more settlements are built. So there is a kind of impatience and despair in people's senses. You know, yes, it may be that this has something to do with singling out the Jews. I'm a Jew. I'm from the Middle East. I'm desperate. I mean, is the BDS movement the way to go? Absolutely not, for the reasons that you cited at the very beginning of your lecture. Mm-hmm. It's a stupid strategy that violates every principle of academic freedom. But I understand why this movement is catching on. I also, you know, understand why some now in Israel are using this movement to try to delegitimize the Netanyahu government. You must have read about Haaretz, you know, right, saying, well, look at what the... So the politics of this issue, you know, are right now multiple, but in politics we always have to ask the question, what are we going to do here now, why? And I think in that sense, we have to ask the question again, is there a way of reviving the peace initiative while admitting the frustration that, you know, the last Likud government, I mean, the Netanyahu governments have been obstructionist?
Well, first of all, I think I basically agree with everything you said. What I can add to it are a couple of things. I don't do everything in this paper. Actually, I cut 10 pages out of it, to your great relief, I'm sure. But I'm in print saying that I would support an economic boycott of the West Bank products, a focused economic boycott of the West Bank. The boycotts that I object to are boycotts of academic and cultural institutions, because I think they accomplish nothing except to violate academic freedom and to separate us from some of the most effective and articulate critics of Israeli government policy. So I am in print saying that I support an economic boycott of West Bank products, and it's possible that such a boycott could be ramped up over time. It fails to succeed, you add another stage. So there are progressive boycott theories. I think it's loathsome to boycott an Israeli symphony, to boycott an Israeli art museum. I mean, those things violate my sense of cultural values substantially. But I think an economic boycott is a form of pressure that could be placed on Bibi's government. And I think there needs to be some pressure placed on them, because I agree with your analysis of the changes in Israeli politics. I mean, I think those are statements of fact, really. They're not even your opinion. They're statements of fact. So I agree with it. Now, the South Africa analogy is very complicated, but just briefly, I guess I can say these things. The South African state was not dismantled and dissolved. So if the comparison is what should happen to South Africa, what happened to South Africa is something like what should happen to Israel proper, Israel, the suggestion, the BDS implications are that one would dissolve the Jewish state. South Africa's government changed, the relative power of its populations changed, but they didn't dissolve the government. So in some ways, the solution for Israel is more extreme. It is simply not true that a vicious apartheid system operates within Israel proper. I mean, if that's the implication, and it often is, it simply isn't true. There are forms of discrimination against Palestinians. There are forms of discrimination against Israeli Jewish minorities, and those need to be dealt with. But those are quite comparable to our own history of long-term and in some ways continuing discrimination in the United States. Those forms of discrimination within Israel's pre-1967 borders just are no basis for a claim that the state should be dissolved, and no basis for a claim that Israel compares to South Africa as an apartheid regime. Now, I think Israel is well on its way to establishing something like an apartheid regime in the West Bank. And that's why I think, in the end, they're simply going to have to unilaterally withdraw if they can't reach a resolution, because having a subject population within its borders is destroying Israeli democracy. And that's also something that I've said in print. I have, in the last 3 months, I've published 5 articles on this stuff, so I didn't, this was new stuff that I hadn't said before, but I'm in print saying all of those things. So I think the South African comparison simply doesn't apply to Israel proper, and that it's an overstatement of the reality in the Palestinian territories. But in any case, it doesn't require massive regime change in Israel or a fundamental change in the character of in the nature of the Israeli state. It requires getting rid of this territory where the conditions that are imposed are intolerable. So I think beyond that, the South Africa comparison is very destructive. It doesn't speak to the totality of the situation.
So actually, my question was going to tie into the very first one about Judith Butler's claims about, or sort of how, what her argument is about the existence of an Israeli state alongside Palestinians, and why it is that Palestinians refuse this or something. And I actually think that Butler's argument has to do with Palestinians living alongside or within, in a lot of cases, a state that continues to perpetuate the injustices that are aforementioned, right? One that continues to occupy these territories, one that continues to deny refugees the right of return, one that continues to discriminate against Palestinian citizens of Israel. And so with that in mind, you know, it's important to acknowledge that the objection is not to the state itself, in the sense that Judith Butler, or the BDS movement for that matter, objects to the name of the state or the color of the flag or the national anthem, right? It's about policies, as you were saying. And so my question is about your definition of a Jewish state. That's a term that you've used a few times. And I'm curious if what we're talking about, what we mean by a Jewish state, is one that is allowed to treat its Palestinian citizens as second-class citizens. Are we talking about, you know, I truly hope that we're not proposing a state in which the kind of democratic change that we saw in South Africa after the fall of apartheid would be impossible. The kind of democratic change that allows for changes in power and changes in demographics would be impossible. And so I think that's sort of, yeah, I hope that you can speak to that, what that Jewish state would look like in your opinion.
Sure. First of all, I think, and this is a subject of debate, but I think it's pretty clear that for many BDS advocates, the occupation refers not just to the West Bank or once upon a time to Gaza, the occupation refers to Palestine. That's integral to a lot of BDS arguments. And that, I think, is a misrepresentation of the history of how land acquisition developed in Israel up until 1936. So I think occupation just doesn't work as if it applies to Israel proper, that is not to the West Bank or to what was once Israel's full control over Gaza, it's really a demand that the state be eliminated. There is, within Israel proper, as I said in the talk, there's real discrimination against its Palestinian citizens, and that has to end. They are not subjugated. I mean, Butler uses the rhetoric of subjugation, not just to apply to Palestinians on the West Bank, where I think it applies and it's completely unacceptable, but also to Israel proper, where I think it's just outlandish as a claim to make. I mean, Palestinian citizens get to vote. They have some representatives in the Israeli government. Many of them have, you know, real careers and opportunities that they treasure. They make less money on average than Israelis do. There are elements of Israeli law that are discriminatory. I mean, Jews who return to Israel from elsewhere, Jews who served in the military, get privileges that Palestinians don't get. There are forms of discrimination that should be eliminated, and they can be eliminated not just by law, but by enforcing the law. The will has to be to enforce those laws to eliminate that discrimination. And my own conviction is that if the borders were settled and Israel had peace, it would be a lot easier for Israeli Jews to reach those accommodations and improve the legal situation of Jews in Palestine. But they're not being subjugated. That's an inaccurate characterization. I'm not saying you said that, but some BDS people do. I think that's an inaccurate characterization. Now, in the course, could Israeli politics change? Certainly. One hopes it would change. I don't care for its present government, that's for sure. It's an obstructionist government, huge problems with it, and that the Israeli electorate could change. You know, but my notion of a Jewish state includes, basically, if you take the populations that are presently in Israel, then a Jewish state will continue to have a Jewish majority. And yes, my notion of a Jewish state means that majority would remain roughly the same. The percentages may be altered over time. It depends on birth rates and immigration and so forth. But I think, you know, it maintains its majority. Would I choose to live in a religious state? No. I've spent a little time in a religious state in the United States called Utah. And I actually found it really eerie and unpleasant and weird to be there, although I have friends there, and they're all kind of ex-Mormons, and they struggle with this past all the time. But, you know, laws in Utah either privilege the Mormon church, or the Mormon church gets to ignore them, and everyone else has to observe them. So I've had a little feeling of what a religious state is like, and I don't like it. And I don't think I'd like a Jewish religious state either. But I'm not an Israeli citizen. That's their choice, right? They deserve that choice of how their national sovereignty should play itself out. Am I willing to entertain a law of return that would alter the demographics of Israel so much that it would cease to be a Jewish state? No, because I don't think that would be a state that would honor the rights of Jewish citizens. There's just nothing in the history of the Mideast that tells me that model is going to grant justice and equal rights to a Jewish minority. Where is the Jewish minority in the Middle East that has or has had in the recent past anything like equal rights? I don't believe that would work. I believe it would result in civil war. So within Israel's current boundaries, there is no mechanism to radically transform its demographics, I think, except by war. And I don't think that would be a good thing for anybody involved. So yes, I mean, that's the best I can say to define a Jewish state, is that it would continue to have a Jewish majority, but its laws would guarantee equal opportunities and an end to discrimination for all of its citizens. It would be a state exercising at least the kind of justice that we have in the United States, which means justice that is flawed and takes a long time to fix, and in people's hearts it remains less than fully observed. But it could be en route to that kind of model. Sure.
Hi. You had mentioned your definition of a Jewish state, and I was wondering, especially that you were a proponent of the two-state solution. I was wondering if there, if in the hypothetical situation, there are a majority of a Jewish majority within pre-1948 borders, if it were to be in a case in which
pre-67 borders.
If there were to be in that case,
pre-1948 borders is really tiny.
If
they have to split the Tel Aviv airport, then go ahead.
If there were to be more Palestinians living within those 67 borders, and would you accept votes of that nature in a sense where what you were considering 67 borders to were actually more Palestinian, or what would be the logic of the Israeli state after that moment when there were more Palestinians in those 67 borders?
Well, at present, Palestinian citizens have full voting rights, something that African Americans didn't always have in the U.S., and if the Republicans win their way in various southern states, they're going to lose their voting rights again. But Palestinian citizens have the full voting rights in Israel. The demographic changes may vary over time. I'm sure they will vary over time. The only way that a Jewish majority would be overwhelmed and eliminated in Israel proper is by the right of return, and I don't support the right of return. I do support, you know, full financial compensation. I do support other kinds of help to Palestinians, but I don't support a right of return. That would radically alter the demographics of the Jewish state, because it couldn't be a Jewish state any longer. And as I say, it's not my ideal for where I'd want to live, but I believe it's what Israelis actually want. That is, I believe the citizens of the Israeli state have a right to determine what their form of sovereignty should be. They have a right. Current citizens have a right to make that determination, and they aren't choosing to eliminate a demographic majority or to eliminate the character of their country. So I think the option that you're thinking of, whereby the demographics changes so radically the Jews are a minority, under my model wouldn't happen. That is, it's purely hypothetical. It just wouldn't take place. I mean, that's the best I can answer you. It's not going to happen. Actually, I don't think it will happen. It's not just that I don't think it should happen. I just don't think it will happen because I don't think Israelis will accept it.
Okay. Thank you for your thoughtful and nuanced critique of Judith Butler's views. In particular, thank you for mentioning what happened to the Jews who lived in Arab and other Muslim lands after the formation of the State of Israel.
And it's about the same number dispossessed, 700,000, the same number, which is kind of weird, but seems to be the case.
I'm wondering what your thoughts are on why this fact is often not mentioned at all, or if it is mentioned, just mentioned in passing, rather than being emphasized more by academics and by journalists.
Well, interesting. Okay, should have invited me. I could have learned something. I think it's not mentioned because it's an inconvenient fact and because it undermines the binary that so controls BDS discourse of an absolute injustice on one side and an absolute right of justice on the other side, of a kind of division between good and evil. And if you start bringing in facts that are kind of inconveniently undermine that binary, you don't want them there. So I think, you know, that's at least initially.
It's also emphasized by people that are arguing for Israel. Mm-hmm.
Right. Well,
it's not inconvenient for them.
No, it's part of the history. I mean, there are many. I mean, for me, actually, the part of the history that's particularly significant are the late 19th and early 20th century land acquisitions by Jews in Israel. which weren't by military force, by the way, because they didn't have any military force. You know, they were purchasing land that was up for sale from Arab landlords who often lived in Damascus or elsewhere. Sometimes the Arab tenant farmers lost their rights to live there as a result. Sometimes they actually collaborated and shared land and worked it together for a period of time. But it wasn't violent dispossession, it was land purchase. And I believe in the United States, we honor land purchase as a principle by which land can exchange hands, which ownership can change. There's kind of, if you don't honor that, then you're, you know, that's quite a different model than I think most of the Western world recognizes. So there are lots of facts like that that are elided, and I think there are facts elided in the discourse of both. And until some of Benny Morris's work on the 1948 war and in Righteous Victims, there was not wide acknowledgement in Israel of the level of violence that was directed toward Palestinians during the 1947-48 war. It's November 47 and then into 1948. Israeli society tended to suppress that knowledge because some of it is really rather disgusting. I mean, there was violence on both sides, but you know, there was definitely violence on both sides, and some of the Israeli violence was really quite horrific. That tended to be ignored in Israel because it too was an inconvenient fact, right? I mean, partisans on both sides tend to like to, you know, not talk about the facts that undermine their case. But my argument is that given that messy history, there's no absolute justice for anybody. Nobody's going to get everything that they think they deserve. It's going to have to be compromise. And if compromise brings peace, over time, I think people can adjust to it. And even though I believe a two-state solution is necessary, there are going to have to be forms of cooperation between a Palestinian state and an Israeli state. I mean, water supplies, sewer systems, there's transportation systems. There are some practical necessities that will require those two states to work together. And if that two-state solution comes as a result of a negotiated settlement, there's a better chance that they can work together in the areas that they have to, rather than coming to a result through war or any of the other solutions. But I think one of the things that American audiences can do, certainly American academics, is try to point out to both sides the facts of history that they are eliding or choosing to forget or choosing not to speak to both sides. You know, this happened, you're not mentioning it. The other side, this happened, you're not talking about it. I think that's one of the productive things that, you know, a kind of academic level of historical knowledge can provide. One of the things I like to say about Palestine is that I just don't know of any other major conflict where history is there in the present time in such a powerful and decisive way. I mean, you know, as I kind of intimated here, in many ways, this conflict is structured the same way it was structured in 1948 over the right of return, over who gets to live where. We haven't really, you know, in some ways stepped an inch beyond that. History is just, it's just powerfully present in this conflict. And when that's the case, you gain a lot by learning more about history, by reading lots of books by Americans, by Israelis, by Palestinians. Read widely across the spectrum, not just read those who support your own positions. Because historical knowledge and historical facts and pressures are so relevant to the situation, academia has a role to play, a traditional role to play in promoting knowledge and promoting recognition of facts. That's kind of what we're good at, supposedly. I don't think we're doing a great job of it at the moment. I don't think either constituency is serving that end well, but it's something that we ought to do.
I have a question, probably two. So my first one is, I find it a bit perplexing that your critique of Judith Butler is the fact that she is operating in this realm of ideas or in rhetoric, right? But her analysis lacks history, or it's not adequately historicized. yet I think you're also critiquing the BDS movement as completely like overlooking the social conditions which ensued the BDS movement and is propelling the BDS movement forward. So for example, you will cite an Israeli physicist who may not have access or may not be able to purchase a particle accelerator, mm-hmm. right? That example is abstract.
No, I've not been able to buy one either. So.
Over-sensationalized, and more importantly, like probably will not ever happen, right? Whereas the social conditions that, for example, Palestinian students or Palestinian academics are like experiencing on their daily and idiosyncratic life, like for example, checkpoints, the fact that they can't go to school, the fact that their schools are bombed on a regular basis, like in Gaza, for example, those things are very immediate, right? And they are what is happening on the ground. So I think that, you know, those are the kinds of social conditions that are ensuing BDS. And the reasons why BDS, I think, is very successful, and the reasons why mm-hmm. students in the United States, academics in the United States, many of whom come from Palestine and Israel, are like sort of latching onto. Second is the reason why you think, or I was hoping that you could unpack, the reason why you think that it's impossible for cohabitation between Palestinians and Israelis. It seems a bit disingenuous that you locate the reason being that, for example, Palestinians can't kind of be okay with standing next to or living or cohabitating with their oppressors. Or there's this sort of like genetic reason or cultural reason or traditional reason.
That's Butler's right. argument, not mine.
Yeah, so that okay. So why is it that Judith Butler is sort of offering that like Palestinians who are sort of compassionate observers of the Holocaust can and do live side by side by Israelis? Like, why is that so crazy to think
about?
Well,
I mean.
Why is it so crazy? Because the reason why the two-state solution is pretty like delusional isn't necessarily because people don't like each other, but because there's 100 Israeli settlements in the West Bank, 100 of them are like sanctioned by the state of Israel. Like the reason why the two-state solution is impossible isn't because Palestinians and Israelis can't get along, it's because of Israeli state policy.
Well, not sure I can keep all of that in my head, but let me try. First of all, the linear accelerator illusion was just because she has this contradictory argument where she says that academic freedom encompasses not just your rights, but it encompasses the infrastructure that you need to do your research. And I think that's wrong. I mean, as someone who's, I've co-authored more AAUP policy documents at this point than, you know, than most living people have written. And we simply would not make that argument. But she argues that, in effect, Israeli faculty members could be denied their access to travel, which is an infrastructural right, but that Palestinians need their infrastructural opportunities are encompassed by academic freedom. I think they both should have their infrastructural opportunities, except academic infrastructure is a product of institutional priority. It's a product of history. It's a product of national policy. It's not something that's really guaranteed. I'm not going to take a phone call in the middle of a talk. Just a second, I'll turn this off. I hope it's not a dinner invitation that I'm missing. I hope that works. If it doesn't, I'll do something more drastic, like smash it. That's why that particular argument came up, and I used the linear accelerator example to give you as an example of a form of infrastructure that it was quite crazy to say is encompassed by academic freedom, right? Academic freedom doesn't guarantee those things. It guarantees you the right to try to get the money for a linear accelerator for anything else, but it doesn't guarantee that you will get the money. I think you're probably right that in this particular paper, because this is really focused on her, I don't give enough space to the real forms of discrimination that West Bank Palestinians suffer from. I allude to it, but I don't put it there in enough detail. And I think that's a fair critique of this, and that I should do something about that. And In a published version, I certainly have enough space to do that. Just dealing with her arguments took me 10 pages more than I read here, but I think you're right that has to be more fully acknowledged in the paper, or I think in the end the paper won't be effective in reaching out to people. It's not, I think you're perfectly right that it is to a significant degree the intolerable conditions on the West Bank that are justifying and fomenting BDS arguments, and that's perfectly true. The key question is not, are those injustices there? Because I think they are. The key question is, how do you fix them, right? What kind of solution would enable them to end? And I believe it's the two-state solution. Now, historically, going all the way back to the late 19th century, there are good examples of local collaboration between Israelis and Palestinians. There are villages that work together. There were Palestinians who had, you know, execrable living conditions and execrable health conditions in the early part of the 20th century, and Jewish immigrants to Israel brought Western medical traditions with them and actually made those available to people. Palestinian farmers in some cases earned better incomes than they had living as tenant farmers. There are lots of those sort of specific examples, and I think they can continue. There's no reason why that kind of cohab collaboration can't work. What made it difficult, okay, is when Palestinian nationalism began to really be a presence in Palestine in the 1920s and 1930s. And Palestinian nationalism is not a sui generis product, it's European nationalism that eventually made its way to the Mideast, and we kind of saw what European nationalism did during that period of time. It produced something called World War I, a lot of dead people, and then it produced World War II. It wasn't really an issue late 19th century in the Middle East. There weren't those strong nationalist traditions. They became prominent in the 20s and 30s and sort of, you know, reached a peak in 1936, and thereafter transformed, I think, Mideast politics in a major way. What impedes the ability of local communities to collaborate are larger political movements that basically engender hostility and opposition and ideological positions that get in the way of local populations getting along. Without those larger political movements, Jews and Arabs have regularly been able to get along in local communities. Unfortunately, we live in a world in which those larger movements are now there. I mean, they influence people. They influence people in the United States, and that makes local cooperation not impossible, but it makes it more difficult. I mean, I'm editing a book on the boycott movement that I hope, if everyone meets their deadlines, will be out before the end of the year, and it's going to have a long chapter, not by me, because I'm no authority on it, about the forms of collaboration between Israelis and Palestinians that now exist. And, you know, they're quite real and they're quite inspiring, and I think there can be more of them. But if you start cooperating and then you think, these people are evil, they've stolen my land, that dot, 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 that cooperation becomes more difficult. So it's really political movements that have undermined the ability of the two peoples to work together. If I missed some parts of your question, I'm sorry.
I agree with most of your critique of Butler, but I really object to your identification of her argument with anti-Semitism. And I feel that is a move that is very objectionable morally, and also intellectually it's not logical. The idea of objective anti-Semitism is kind of like objective anti-communism. I mean, it's kind of, what is the effect of something? It could encourage anti-Semitism, but it's an attribution of motives or ideologies where it's an attempt to undermine and connect the moral criticism or political criticism and political argument, let's say, with racism. Mm-hmm. And it's the same thing that the other side often does too. So my question would be whether you can defend that and whether it's, you believe, central. Is it central to the argument against the boycott to claim that it's actually anti-Semitic? Or that, you know, certain, that's, the other thing I'd say is that if you want to look at the motive or the ideology behind Butler's kind of critique, I talk about post-coloniality, that this movement of, that's been going on for 50 years of complete identification with the victims of imperialism, which you point out, is a problem that has made it difficult to develop moral and political criticisms of post-colonial states, post-colonial actors. And in this case, Israel is a colonialist, is acting in the position of a colonial power with a horrible occupation, which you seem to agree that it is an immoral occupation, which causes tremendous suffering. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, I see you trying to balance these two things. I think that you destroy the balance by moving into the argument that it's anti-Semitic, when there's so much injustice. I think people like Butler are overwhelmed with the sense of injustice that's going on because of the Israeli occupation, and they're resolving it in a very unsatisfactory way.
Yeah, well, I think you only tried to answer. I mean, I think, first of all, in the West Bank, Israel is operating in the manner of a colonialist power. What Butler actually says is that from its inception, the Jewish immigration to Palestine was colonialist in its motive and in its mode of operations. In other words, she makes the colonialist argument from the late 19th century on. And that, I think, is just historically inaccurate. It would be a long argument to try to demonstrate why that, I think, isn't true.
That's so, what I'm saying, it's a post-colonial argument that she's making. Mm-hmm.
That she's drawing on the current.
She's making a post-colonial argument.
Right, but she's applying it to a history where I think it simply doesn't apply. I agree that it applies in the West Bank. I don't think it applies to the whole of the history of Jewish settlement in Palestine. Now, the anti-Semitism question does upset people, and you produced your distress much more mildly than people usually do, for which I congratulate you. I think it's a question that has to be talked about, and that's really what I'm urging, is that it not be a kind of prohibited discourse. Do I think that Butler is anti-Semitic? Not in any way that I can demonstrate, and that's really not what I was arguing. I was arguing that there are anti-Semitic elements within BDS's position, and that it is in some ways made possible by the long history of anti-Semitism. In other words, what makes Israel the prime violator of human rights on planet Earth? What makes it the site of injustice that exceeds and transcends all other forms of national injustice on the planet? And to me, nothing rational in what actually has happened in the Mideast warrants that absolute distinction. I think you get that distinction, and it's fueled in the end by the long history that isolates the Jews, others the Jews, and in some way creates Israel as an othered entity, an othered entity from its inception. And I believe that that concept and that perception draws on the history of anti-Semitism. And I think that needs to be analyzed much more thoroughly. It's been very difficult for academics to try to write about that because they're instantly accused of saying that all opponents of Israeli policy are anti-Semites. And that's just nonsense. I mean, you have to be able to oppose government policies. I do think that when you say that the state was a colonialist enterprise from the get-go and that justice can only be served if it is eliminated, that denies the rights of self-determination for Israeli citizens now, and that that's in some ways fueled by anti-Semitism. But I can't claim to have really worked that out thoroughly. I think we're only starting to do it. I think that conversation needs to go on, and that it's going to require a lot of academic analysis. So my bottom line is just to say we need to reflect on that and talk about it and try to work out the relationship between anti-Semitism and the demand that the state of Israel be eliminated. Where I think it's in that domain that it has the most relevance, and I think people will be troubled by the discussion, because I'm not trying to claim that any given person is an anti-Semite. I think it's a useless slander that for the most part serves no purpose whatsoever. But I do think in some ways the philosophy of the movement is drawing on anti-Semitic traditions, and that that needs to be faced squarely.
Okay, we're going to have two more questions and then we'll move on to the reception. You've been waiting patiently on this gentleman here. Go ahead.
I have two follow-up questions to Professor Alexander's question about anti-Semitism. The first is you've said several things about eliminating prohibitions on discourse, and I think that makes a lot of sense. But is there a way in which bringing anti-Semitism into the discussion prohibits various BDS positive discourses by labeling them as anti-Semitic and then kind of by doing so making them taboo?
Well, I mean I think the straw man or straw woman that Butler demolishes, I think, is a gratuitous one, and that's the assertion that any criticism of Israeli policy is anti-Semitic. If you conduct the discussion that way, then I think you're right. It closes off any conversation. First of all, I think it's kind of crazy, as a matter of fact. I mean, there's an awful lot of criticism of Israeli government policy in Israel. It's hard to find more criticism of government policy in Israel. It's a very fractious population. You know, it's not a kind of non-debating, non-argumentative population. It's just the opposite. That's all anti-Semitic? I don't think so. There's some pretty loyal citizens that engage in that kind of criticism. So that blocks discussion. Do I think that that raising the issue at all in the kind of way that I've tried in a very preliminary way, my argument is not a thorough argument. It's going to take a lot of work to lay that out. Do I think that blocks conversation? Well, it's not blocking our conversation. It didn't block my conversation with him. So, you know, if you do it in a civilized way, I'm a great believer in civilized discourse, frankly. I think it's one of the things the Academy should specialize in. Not necessarily collegiality. I don't believe in respecting everyone's opinion. I think they're wrong opinions. I believe trying to respect persons rather than the positions that they take. And I think if you conduct yourself in a certain kind of way, then you can try to talk through that issue in a compatible way. Is that necessarily what we've seen on either side? Hell no. I think either side uses it as a weapon. The claims of anti-Semitism or denials of anti-Semitism is used often as a silencing weapon. But it doesn't have to be. I mean, you can talk about it, you know, in a way that you remain compatible and try to think through what the relationship between a long tradition that isolates Jews and has done so for centuries might be, and the absolute isolation of the Israeli state. I think that's something worth thinking about. And I think also you have to look accurately and historically at the character of Arab anti-Semitism, which predates the history of Israel by some period of time. Actually, one of my long-term friends just a few years ago Jeffrey Herf made this huge discovery of transcripts of the Nazi broadcasts that were made to the Middle East in Arab languages in the 30s and the 40s that violently promoted anti-Semitism. So there were radio broadcasts encouraging Arab anti-Semitism before the State of Israel was founded, and it helped shape that kind of antagonism. So I think that has to be faced as well. It doesn't do any good to kind of prohibit discussions of Arab anti-Semitism because, you know, it's part of what makes some Jews in Israel feel existentially threatened. Now, maybe their fear is irrational, maybe it's exaggerated, But not talking about it doesn't help deal with it. If they feel the presence of Arab anti-Semitism and it makes them less willing to work out a negotiated solution, then denying it and telling them they shouldn't mention it or shouldn't talk about it won't get you anywhere. What you have to do is try to talk about it, try to discover what the historical realities are, try to get acknowledgement of those realities, and you know, work it through. So I think there are elements of anti-Semitism in this picture, in the Middle East as a whole, and I'm not talking now about BDS in the United States or Palestine or England or wherever. I'm talking now about Arab anti-Semitism in Egypt, in worst of all, in Iran. You got to talk about that stuff. And if you block it from conversation in a civil way, you won't reach a solution that people have confidence in. So that's the best I can do to address it. I find one-on-one arguments about the Middle East to be totally useless. I do not engage in them. It's a waste of time. I'm trying to persuade hundreds of people, not one.
Makes a lot of sense. I guess where I was coming from was your comment early in the talk that any argument that denied the right of existence to a Jewish state was an anti-Semitic argument. And it seems like that's an argument that we could entertain in various other ways, such as an anti-nation state argument that has nothing to do with anti-Semitism.
Well, it's an anti-nation state argument which is directed toward one nation. Why is that? Why is it okay for us to retain a nation? And why is it okay for Canada and Britain and you know, scores of other countries to maintain their nation state existence, but not that one? So there's some of the fuel that fires that notion that Israel is an exceptional entity whose national state identity is illicit, I think draws on those traditions. But I offer that as a challenge that we can talk about. I mean, I'm willing to talk about that claim as well. I sort of threw it out as a challenge, and I have some belief that the challenge is well grounded, but it's not beyond discourse, it's not beyond conversation. What I most get out of talking about these issues with other people is learning how they feel and where they're coming from. That's the personal benefit that I get most often is getting a feel for how people have developed their passions and their convictions and their positions and what kind of information underlies it.
Thank you. So before I launch into my two-pronged question, I want to maybe actually engage in basically, in what you just said, sort of in response to Jonah's question, which is that I think, given your answer to the earlier question about what you consider to be a Jewish state, which was, and correct me if I'm wrong, sort of roughly a state in which there is a Jewish majority, any nation state argument that argues for a Canadian nation or a British nation that would operate under the language of preserving a British or a Canadian majority, I think would instantly ignite the same exact kind of criticisms that are coming towards Israel. So I sort of think that that's an unfair distinction that you...
Can I speak to that a bit? I think that's a very clever argument. It's an interesting argument. One would say certain things, or one could say certain things. First of all, none of those other states that you've cited is existentially threatened in quite the way that Israel is. That kind of separates its history. Then there's another issue. A big part of this paper that I didn't read was the relationship between the state of Israel and the Holocaust. And one of my quips about the Holocaust, if you can make a quip about the Holocaust, is that the Holocaust helps justify the founding of the state of Israel, but it doesn't justify West Bank settlements. It doesn't justify current Israeli policy. And allusions to it, I think, are illicit. But that, for me, and historically, the relationship between the Holocaust and Israel is very complex. It certainly was one of the motives behind the UN vote in 1947, although some of the states that voted for the creation of the State of Israel weren't motivated by the Holocaust. They were motivated by political pressures from the United States, which was the prime engine behind the vote. So it's a complex relationship, but it did provide a homeland for victims of the most astonishing piece of 20th century genocidal violence. And I think that puts Israel in a different place in my mind than it does Canada or Britain or the other countries. I think Israel is a multicultural society in the present time, and I think it can be a more multicultural society over time. And there are, the notion of a Jewish state does provide real problems and challenges for a society that wants to be multicultural. And those are challenges Israel has to struggle with and try to ameliorate. And I've suggested some of the ways that they can do so legally by ending discrimination. There are, happily, plenty of Palestinians who now speak Hebrew and can take advantage of political action within Israel proper. And, you know, certainly Israeli universities welcome Palestinian students. There are, you know, signs of progress that promote a multicultural society within Israel, but there will always be tensions between that multicultural society and the character of a state that remains fundamentally Jewish. I think that's perfectly true. Sorry, go ahead.
No, not at all. I mean, yeah, I mean, I think there's a lot to talk about there as well. And actually, my question originally was sort of related to the answer that you just gave, which is I was interested in sort of poking at your arguments against the Palestinian right of return. One of the things that you said, sort of been discussing it, that you know many states, including this one, including the United States, regularly undertake policies to sort of control or somehow regulate the body that participates in defining the democratic polity. The first part of the question, which is sort of small in scope, I think, compared to the second part, so I'm going to ask them sort of side by side first, if that's okay. I guess I was just wondering if you could talk, which policies exactly do you mean? Because when I heard that, I thought voter ID laws, sort of draconian immigration policies, gerrymandering, all these sort of things that we could have potentially conceive of as quite politically problematic and would be a strange thing to kind of use to uphold a nation's policies that we're supporting. And the second sort of part of my question is, other arguments that you gave against the Palestinian right of return included the idea that many of the people who were originally part of the sort of displaced families were sort of aging and dying. There was a sort of lost memory and lost connection, perhaps on a sort of cultural level to this place, and that specifically you said that this sense of loss could be unlearned. And third, of course, the sort of main argument, right, is that implementing such a policy would sort of fundamentally restructure the political character of that region. Of course, all three of those arguments could be with devastating effect, I think, mobilized against the original and ongoing Jewish right of return. First of all, why is it that the Jews haven't unlearned this sense of loss over centuries and centuries? Mm-hmm. Secondly, the sort of argument against sort of fundamentally restructuring. I guess what I'm saying is, if that is the case, and if you agree that on a certain level you can sort of draw out this homology between these two kinds of arguments that you're presenting, and it's okay to agree with that and then still think that in the case of the Jewish right of return there is legitimacy, in the case of the Palestinian right of return for whatever reason there isn't, and if that's what you're doing, which is acceptable, that could be coherent. I wonder how you can then sort of dismiss, in the way that you have, or that sort of just did, arguments specifically against the creation of the State of Israel and its legitimacy as anti-Semitic, rather than falling on a different side of the. And I mean, please don't only answer that last part, because it's less interesting.
That was exactly what I was going to do. Damn.
I know.
Look, I don't think it's a legitimacy versus illegitimacy argument, but I think if I tried to make that claim, I think I would be not being fair to the reality. I'm making an interested claim that there's a history behind the founding of the Jewish state, and I'm willing, because of that special history, to support the Israeli right to exist and to set an immigration policy which is biased. And that's an interested commitment. It is certainly not a claim that the Palestinian right to return is illegitimate and the Israeli right to return is legitimate. I mean, I think that would be a shoddy argument for me to make. I agree with you on that. I hope that's not what I'm making. I'm saying that I have an investment in that, in the Jewish state staying a Jewish state. That's an investment that does reinforce the values that present citizens have. I mean, I think that's what the citizens who actually live in Israel would prefer. Butler wants the people to be who make the vote of, in effect, about the status of Palestine to be all Palestinians and Jews. And in that case, Jews lose the numerical advantage and they would lose the vote. I think that's pretty safe to say. I'm making an interested commitment, which for me is strongly linked to my knowledge of the Holocaust. I regularly teach a course in Holocaust poetry. It's probably the most powerful course that I teach. It's the course that students find the most exciting and also the most difficult course they take, because the challenge to their sense of what it means to be human is radically threatened by that, by reading that body of literature, more dramatically with poetry than any other form of writing because of the metaphoric character that poetry has. So, you know, I'm looking at those relative rights from an invested position. It's nothing better or worse than that. It is an invested position, not making a claim for the justice of one and the injustice of the other. The only claim I'm making is for the impracticality of the Palestinian right of return, because it would overturn that state. I mean, that's, you know, it's not a moral argument, except to the extent that you do or don't grant the formation of Israel as having a relationship to the Holocaust and what special character that gives it. If you choose to say it gives it no special character, so be it. It's a matter of conviction on my part, and it's a belief in the distinctive nature of that historical set of events. I can't justify it any more than by that. So what did I miss in your question?
Well, why don't we continue this conversation? You've worked really hard, and we have a reception waiting out there. So let's say thank you.